Good evening, everyone. For those who don't know me, my name is Henrik Selin. I work here at BU, and I teach classes on environment and sustainable development, including climate change. And it's my honor to welcome you and our speaker here tonight. I know it's St. Patrick's Day, so I'm glad you decided to come here before you go out and paint the town green. So our speaker today is Harald Welzer, who has a long, long resume. Among other things, he is the head of the Center for Interdisciplinary Memory Research at the University of Essen, but perhaps more important for what he's going to talk about today, he's also the professor for transformation design at University of Flensburg and the executive director of a foundation called FuturZwei, which looks at sort of future societies and think about the future. He is an extremely prolific writer who has published a large number of books that have been translated into a number of different languages. I think the last number I saw was 12 or 15 or something like that.
Every week more.
See, there we go, right? Just keep coming up. And the main reason he's here, which particular book, is this one with a rather provocative title, Climate Wars, and perhaps an even more provocative subtitle, Why People Will Be Killed in the 21st Century. And Harald told me before that he will start his presentation today with this book as the jumping off point. It was published in Germany in 2008. And was published in English in 2012, by Polity Press. And then he will also talk a little bit about sort of what happens after the book was published, and then also move into a more general area of sort of sustainability transformation at the societal level and so forth. And we will start with a presentation about 45, 50 minutes or so. And then we'll definitely open up the floor for a question afterwards. So please gather all the questions you have, and we'll hopefully have not just an interesting presentation, but also a very fruitful and stimulating discussion afterwards.
Yeah, good afternoon. Thank you very much for inviting me here and for this introduction. The most important point is that for me, this book is now 6 years old and had a big influence on what I do now, because at that time I was at the Institute für Kulturwissenschaften at Essen and working in a relatively conventional way as an academic. And now I do something totally different, and that has a lot to do with this study and with this book. So what I want to present you today is a brief outline of the idea and the content of the book, and then report a little bit how I would position this book in the current discussion about transformation and environmental issues, and also if you're interested in the German green politics and Energiewende thing, because this is a very complicated but also very interesting thing. And then I want to talk a little bit about practical strategies to move towards a more sustainable modern society, what I would call a move from an expansive modernity to a reductive modernity. But this comes in the end. So to give you some idea of my background, I'm not an environmental scientist, I'm not an environmental psychologist, I just came to this topic of climate change because I come from violence research and theories about mass violence and things like that. I'm a social psychologist and worked many, many years on topics of mass crimes, societal crimes, mass killings, and things like that. And as a social psychologist, my question was, why people who would never think of themselves as being able to kill or have the willingness to kill somebody else under certain conditions, under certain social circumstances, would decide exactly to do this and would be able to apply some kind of sense to what they do, although it's completely different from their self-concept. And this is a psychological question that's very interesting. It's also a political question that's very interesting. And it's also in terms of education and all pedagogical aspects quite interesting, because for a long time in history and also in the educational literature, there was always this question, how can we prevent people from doing evil things? It's a very old question. It was never answered sufficiently. And we saw, especially in the 20th century, many, many examples where people who would be from their self-concept, from their moral convictions, from their religious orientations, without much effort to be brought to the decision to kill other people. Although, if you would have asked these very same persons 2 or 3 months before, if they would ever be able to do something like this or willing to do something like this, they would have answered, no, why should I? This is not my self-concept and this is not the ideology and not the culture that I come from to kill other people. So, and we did a lot of studies in this respect. The last one was very interesting because of the material that we could use. This book was also published in English, called Soldaten. And the material is really spectacular because we found that the British Army, as well as the American Army, bugged German prisoners of war's conversations. So they had special camps with microphones and all kinds of things, and they were listening to their everyday conversations about the war, about raping women, about techniques and whatever were men would talk about. And so we have a material of 150,000 transcribed pages of the perspective of the ordinary German soldier. And this is an unbelievable material because you won't have any comparable thing. It doesn't exist, yeah? Not even from contemporary things, because these things are very well hidden. And this is really a unique material. And it's quite interesting because different from other material that you can use to find something out about mindsets, of historical mindsets at a given contemporary point of 1941 or something, these are all materials that are addressed to somebody, like in memoirs or so. They are mostly after the fact. They are never in real time of the events, and they are intended to perform, to sketch yourself as a person so-and-so, because much of this material comes from the trials afterwards and whatever. So here we have conversations where these guys are sitting in their cells and they don't have anything to do, so they talk about what they did. So this gives a lot of material to reconstruct the perspective, to reconstruct what they saw and made them act from their point of view in the way they acted. And I don't want to go too deep into this, but what was really striking in this material was that the picture of the German Wehrmacht soldier as the willing executioner, who is driven by ideology, who is driven by the Nazi concepts of racial inequality and anti-Semitism and so, only applies to a minority of these soldiers. It applies very much to the SS. We have also SS soldiers in the material. There the ideological aspect is much stronger, as in the Wehrmacht. But these people do all the atrocities that they frankly report amongst each others without any ideological conviction, which makes it even more frightening and puzzling, because they report very in a very epic way, rapings of women, killing of enemies and whatever. They report all kinds of crimes they committed, and they report also surprisingly much about what we later called the Holocaust, which means the extermination by direct killings and later by the mode of the extermination camps. This is interesting because there was always a big discussion, especially in Germany, but also in the international debate amongst historians, how much the Germans knew about it and how much the Wehrmacht soldiers knew. And we could relatively, with this material, could show that everybody knew everything, which has a very simple reason. I mean, this doesn't mean that each inhabitant of Germany at that point knew everything about what was happening in the concentration camp, but the soldiers knew, because when they were traveling home in the holidays, they were all in these trains, and they did the same as they were doing in these camps where they were imprisoned afterwards. So talking about what they heard and what they did. So these trains worked as media, yeah, to commit all kinds of news from the front and what happened to everybody else. And when they were home, of course, these stories have been re-narrated. And to our surprise, this material is so rich that we found things on the extermination process that haven't been known by the historical research before. Very surprising, although the narratives about these things is only like 3% of the whole amount of the narrative. So this is a very interesting material, especially for the point to reconstruct what they saw, how they reinterpreted it. And just one thing, because this has to do with the topic of this afternoon. We found something that might sound extremely contradictory, because these guys did all kinds of cruel things without having much problems with it. Most of them reported proudly. We have examples where they invent cruel things that didn't happen in reality. This says something about how they can gain status and so, what kind of communicative mode they were in. But they have also, they distance themselves from certain types of killing and violence. And this is quite interesting, because they report on the one hand that they dislike how the German Wehrmacht leaders treated the Russian prisoners of war. This is one of the most brutal chapters in the history of the Second World War, because the German Wehrmacht let these people, these Russian prisoners, starve, treated them extremely bad. Millions of them died, was totally against the conventions and so. And these happenings, these phenomena, are highly criticized in the conversations of the soldiers. And they say, you cannot treat people like this. They don't like it. They don't accept it. They find it really awful. Why? Because these other guys are soldiers. They do the same job as they do. And they sit in the British and American camps, are treated totally different. And they cannot accept it, because they put it in a military frame of reference. So this is not correct. On other occasions, they tell stories about that they made prisoners, Russian soldiers, Red Armies, and shot them right away. And this is totally okay. It's absolutely okay. No problem with that. Because there are situational factors that they would have trouble to bring them back, yeah, to their camp or whatever, and maybe getting into trouble by themselves, so they kill them. Quite normal. No discussion about this. Yeah, same seemingly contradiction between reports about killing of Jews, and they don't like it. Either they don't like it, the things that have been reported to them, or a few have been involved, and nobody likes it. Nobody is affirming this, that there are women and kids are killed just because the SS ordered it and whatever. And they don't like it at all. But this is not because they have another political idea about it or some moral judgment. This is because they don't understand what this what this has to do with military action. They have no idea. Because, you know, preparing the grounds for killing people and then shooting women and kids has nothing to do with war. It has nothing to do with, by their perception, the idea why they are there. It's not nothing that has to do with their job. On the other hand, when they have... when they think they fight against partisans and burn down villages and kill women and children, it's completely okay. Because there's a reference frame that this is fighting partisans. A partisan can be everybody. We have also these episodes from the Vietnam Creek and from My Lai and whatever. So the interesting thing is that the most important mode of sense-making and position actions that one has done by himself is to put in different reference frames. That means as soon as you have something where you have a kind of frame for sense making, for ordering in something that is understood as my ordinary task, as something that has to be done because I'm here to have to do something like this, it's okay. And they have no moral judgment about it. As soon as it is something that seems to be unprofessional to them or not justified by any concept or so, they find it completely bad to do this. And this gives a hint to the role of background factors like ideology, political convictions, and all these things. And after we did this study, we had the interpretation that these ideological questions are totally overvalued in historical interpretations. It is not, because we can also show that we have in this material totally convinced Nazis, a huge group of apolitical soldiers who don't have the slightest interest in politics and whatever. So there's one quote from a guy who was interviewed by an American officer and comes back to his cell and says to his comrade, "Do you know, he was asking me, I should have to explain the political system in Germany. I have no idea what that is." So they have no idea about these things, apolitical. And then we have a group of decidedly anti-Nazi guys, ex-communists and whatever, because all these people were in the German army. And they have political debates in this conversation. But as soon as it comes to concrete military action, to concrete performance of violence, they don't differ at all. They don't differ at all. They do all the same. They can fight against each other in an argumentative way when it comes to this abstract concepts. Is Hitler a good guy or not? Nazis, whatever. So, but in a professional sense, doing their jobs, they do all the same. So for the better and the worse, in both directions, ideological, political, and whatever ethical convictions don't do anything or almost nothing when it comes to fulfill a perceived task. What is required from me, what people want from me, is the certain point. And as people act in groups in this situation, it is even more so because the reference group of persons is the actual group that they are in and not the teacher back in Germany, not somebody who is giving political speeches, not the mother, whatever. So these factors are quite interesting. So to sum this up, this work on these mass violence things made it much more, to me, much more appropriate to think about violence in situational frames, not so much in ideological or personality psychology respects. Yeah, there's a huge tradition to trace this tendency to act violently back to biographies and personal structures and things like that. It's much more the concrete situation. And therefore, the work that we did in this respect is not so much historical, is not adding data to historical knowledge, but it's much more about potential. What can be executed under given conditions? What can be done with people? And the interesting thing is that you can almost do everything, and people are always, almost any time, able to apply sense to it. This is an interesting mode, yeah, that they want to do their job really good. And this requires some kind of personal subjective addition to it. I want to do this better than my comrade and whatever. So this mode of sense making makes the people identified even with something where they would never have thought that they could do it. Okay, we can go deeper into this in the discussion. Then I was interested, but not scientifically, but just on an everyday level, in all these issues of climate change and all the reports and papers and the scenarios that were developed of climate researchers developed as future perspectives. And at a certain point, I thought, well, okay, if these guys are right, what does it mean for the potential for violence in the future? Because if they are right, then it simply means that the living conditions and the survival conditions in different parts of the world will go under stress, even more stress in already stressed areas. And what will people do then? What does it mean? And then I was trying to search the literature and try to find something about this specific aspect, the interrelationship between climate change and violent conflict. And to my surprise, there was almost nothing about it. And to my even greater surprise, I realized at this point, this is like 10, 12 years ago, that the whole field of climate impact research was to 95 or 99% dominated by scientists and not by people from the humanities, not by historians, not by sociologists, and so. Yeah? And I thought, wow, this is amazing, because what this data reveals is a prognosis about changing circumstances of survival. Because what cultures and groups always do, nowadays on a sophisticated level, but basically is to find practices of survival. And if this is changing so severely, why wouldn't there be any type of research about it? And so this was the starting point, because, I mean, it's a very banal thing, that this is not to say that this is not the job of meteorologists or oceanologists and all these people. They don't have any idea what this means for cultures and for societies and for individuals. They can say, okay, we have this data and we can have the ABC so-and-so scenario for that, but they have no idea what this means. So there's a great lack, and now in the last years, more people engaged in this field, but at that time I found it really interesting, because for the Earth system doesn't care if it's changing or not. Not even the climate has any kind of interest in its change. Yeah? It doesn't matter at all. The whole unbelievable amount of data is only relevant in terms of what it says about the future of cultures, societies, and individuals. So then I tried to make this sketch in where this book, Climate Wars, is the product. The title is spectacular, especially the subtitle. And it's on, not only spectacular, but only also speculative. Because this book is not something where you would find sentences like we will see a war between Afghanistan and whatever in the year 2035 because of the desertification in this and that area. Not in this concrete way. What this book tries to do is to investigate potentials for future conflicts. And it has three different perspectives. One is a historical one, the other one is collecting data for contemporary phenomena, and one is future outlooks. And the potentials that I see or saw at that point are very simple. And I just can mention them briefly here because it's really simple. It's totally evident that in the case where you have restricted living conditions, like in sub-Saharan Africa or whatever, you will face immediately very dangerous problems when you have phenomena like land degradation, like desertification and whatever. And then you have these situations where people, different groups, start to compete about the same piece of land. In the Darfur case, for example, the herders and the farmers. And their competition grows, of course, harder when this land disappears. And then you can reconstruct the development of violent conflicts there. Very simple. Because if the survival conditions are influenced directly, you will have direct violence. This is not a surprise. But what is important in this respect is, and therefore the Darfur example is instructive, is that this is only the case that you have something like this direct relationship between environmental changes and violent conflict if this takes place in a condition where you have a failed state with not non-functioning regulations and where you have many, many different actors in the field who would also be interested in violent conflict, who would be interested in bringing weapons into this field, who would be interested in formatting this into ethnic conflicts and whatever. So the potential of violent conflict in the context of these environmental changes is never a monocausal thing. There is never one single reason that it comes to something like this, but it's complicated and always related to the given conditions. So that under other circumstances, like with water conflicts or something like this, depending on the capacity of the respective states to solve conflicts, to make contracts or whatever, the same type of conflict can find a totally different end and might not end up in violent conflict. So, but this is something severe because we have many failed states, we have many interested parties in escalating conflicts and whatever. So this is one field where we see more potential. And in this book, there's a list of low-level conflicts that have a relationship to environmental changes that again have a relationship to climate change, and you will see a surprising number of conflicts that have this relationship, much more than we would normally see when we see the news or read about the statistics of wars and whatever. So this is one aspect that has a direct relationship, scarcity of resources because of the impact of climate change. The other thing is related to this, and this is migration, because many people do not migrate because of the direct impact of climate change, but the indirect, that there is a conflict and they have to go. They themselves perceive what they have to do, not in this context. They perceive the others as aggressors or whatever, and they see that they have to leave the country. And then you have two big scenarios for conflicts. The one is the Binnenmigration, the migration in the country, which is very, very difficult, as we all know, because especially in poor countries, there's always organizational deficits and competition between the people who are there and whatever, and the other aspects to migrate across the borders and to try to find some land or society where you can make a living or survive. And then we have this indirect consequences of climate change also on the European level, because this constant perceived problem of too much migration from Africa to Europe is of course puzzling all the European administrations and so on. There's huge interest and huge investments in border control and whatever. And the only effect that this has is that normally the refugees would take routes with higher risk, and we have more people who die in the Mediterranean seas and whatever. But this is also a potential for more violent, for more violence in the future, and also moving in the dialectics between security, perceived need for security, and the willingness to let people not participate in your beautiful life and better conditions. So there's also an escalative dynamics in it. Another aspect is what happens when, because of the melting ice, routes become free where you can do transportation and so, and have shortcuts compared to the time 20 years ago, whatever, and the whole field of resources, raw materials that can be accessed because the ice is going away. And the very difficult problem that the international regulations in this field are not very elaborated, and it's always, if there are raw materials, interesting resources, there's always a potential for conflict. So, and then one can say that in the end, we will see a deepening of the potentiality of the societies who are on the winner side of the whole process, at least for the next decades, and the ones who are on the loser side. German sociologist Lars Clausen called this the failed globalization, because what he saw in his analysis was that, of course, if the stress is getting higher and the problems for many societies become more severe and deeper, the organizational power of the others who don't have these problems but are richer and better organized and whatever grow relatively bigger. So the balances of power change by this process. And we will see, that was his perspective, we will see with the ongoing process a division, a very much deeper division of winners and losers. And I think this is not unrealistic. And I think it is also to be observed even now in the present, and it's not a future thing. So, and this makes the whole perspective a little bit depressing. But because there are not many indicators that things will change into a better direction. And now a brief report on what happened in the German discussions after this book was published. This book was widely received by reviews and whatever, and it was people bought this book and discussed it and whatever. So it was some kind of debate about it, and I gave many talks about it to different audiences. And what I found really interesting, as somebody who was absolutely not part of the eco scene, the sustainability scene, the climate scene, so like an ethnologist came to these new audiences, making presentations about this book, and then there were these discussions afterwards, and people were really interested, and of course all these audience were they already converted, you know, who goes to presentations like this, people who are interested in climate change and things like that. But all these discussions always ended with a few people asking the question, oh, what can we do? Do you have any idea? And then I thought, after this happened 30 times or something, then I thought, well, okay, when did the whole ecological and environmental movement start? When was it? One significant point, 1972, Limits to Growth. There was, of course, 10 years before Rachel Carson and so, but we have 40 to 50 years, a movement that is very much concerned about environmental problems and so. And what does it mean if we have this since many decades and people who are highly interested in these issues and highly identified with this topic would sit there and always ask the same question, what can we do? There must be something wrong in the whole thing, because there's no answer. And to go a bit deeper into this and to sharpen this observation, one can also say we have in societies like the German, the Swiss, the French, here in America, of course, during this last 40 years, a heightened consciousness concerning these environmental, ecological, and climate issues. If we look at the questionnaires, at the things where people are asked what they are concerned about, and all these things, we see that people are really here, as I know, in the States not so much, but in Germany people are really concerned about climate change, for example. And we don't have the scene of climate skeptics and so. So therefore it's a very broad cognitive and emotional involvement in these things. And if you look at the ads for new cars, for example, you will always find ads that would say that the new Porsche Cayenne is very good for the environment and is also very good for the climate. In the end, it was constructed to do something for the climate. If you look at the statements, the leading statements of the companies, you will always find the words sustainability and climate protection and so. So we have on the, and if you look at the schools and the kindergarten and so, all these topics are very much on the agenda, so that we can say during the last 40 years, we had a very, very successful movement in changing mindsets. Absolutely great. Green Party, all these things. And a little bit puzzling is a look to the numbers. When you look at the growth rates in CO2 emissions, in the rates of extracted materials, in the rates of produced waste and all these things, then you will see some parallel lines. One is the increased consciousness, and the other one is the increased use of material energy and the production of waste and emission. And I think this is really, really something, and now I speak again as a social psychologist, this is really a puzzling thing. how these two developments coexist without producing schizophrenia or deep dissonances and whatever. So, but then the question is there an interrelationship between knowledge and action? This is what everybody thinks, that there's an interrelationship, and all educational efforts in this field. We have this decade of Bildung für nachhaltige Entwicklung, education for sustainable development. Much is invested in this, but the underlying idea is as soon as people know something, they would act accordingly. But what we see is the exact opposite of it. They know really a lot, but they do everything totally different. It's quite interesting. And if you look at the numbers, and I did this after these debates and after reflecting about these things, that we have in Germany as well as in the US and in the rich countries, we have a doubling of all product segments every 10 years. This is really something surprising, yeah, in the context of these discussions. We have every 10 years the double consumer amount, the double amount of products in textiles, for example. We have the doubling in 10 years in furniture, and not to talk about all these electronic things and whatever. And what we see is a constant increase in the material used for producing these products, and a shortening in the cycles of these products, because yeah, they're very, very short. The new car comes very much faster, the new phone and whatever. And people think that they are highly conscious about environmental issues. They look at the labels. They want to buy the most efficient product, but they don't realize that they buy much, much more of these highly efficient products than ever before. And the growth rates in these fields are really amazing. And if you take in respect that this is now a worldwide thing, and the globalization means that this principle is spreading all over the world, we have a very severe problem. And this problem is not addressed by telling people something about environmental problems. Yeah, because this is not mixed. To be cynical, one could say what capitalism managed to do, and this is, capitalism is really a brilliant principle because it can incorporate everything. What it managed to do after the limits to growth and the first stage and phase of a deep discussion is to establish a new field, because capitalism is about division of labor. So here we have this problem. Oh God, all these environmental problems, whatever. We need people who professionalize in dealing with these environmental problems. We need people who write books about it. We need institutions that are established to be concerned. We need international conferences, whatever. And this is a new field. This is, let's say, the industry of the concerned. And we have this other field. This is the industry of the non-concerned who do their business as usual. And they don't disturb each other that much. It works. Capitalism works this way. And from a psychological point of view, what is quite interesting is that we don't realize, as members of a given society, the changing process of these societies, because we move within the changing circumstances, the shifting baselines phenomenon, that you don't have an indicator what has changed. So that people, for example, in Germany, don't have the slightest idea that their living conditions differ extremely from the conditions only 20 years ago, they wouldn't realize it. They complained that everything is so expensive, that gas is so expensive, that goods are so expensive, that milk is so expensive. And if you look at the statistics, you will see that everything is extremely cheap compared to the time 20 years ago, and even much cheaper compared to 40 years ago. What people had to invest in work to buy a television set or jeans or whatever or a bread was much, much more than it is today. Yeah, but they think, everybody thinks, okay, things are getting more expensive all the time. And they think it was always the case that you could go into some electric store and could find 200 different machines to produce coffee, and that your only problem is to find the best one out of it. I mean, all these things that have changed and that are not perceived, that sometimes one has to alienate oneself and go into these stores without any expectation. And this was, for example, the case, therefore I mentioned the coffee machines. I was never interested in coffee machines, but my old espresso machine didn't work anymore. So I walked into one of those malls and was totally surprised that there were 200 machines. 20 years ago, you would have had maximum two or something like this. So this is what you see. If you look at the cars, cars is something quite interesting because if you take a car like the Mini, everybody knows the Mini, right? This car that is produced by BMW originally was British. This is quite interesting because when the Mini was invented, the Mini had a weight of 640 kilos and it had 34 horsepowers, but four people could fit into this car, and everybody was happy with it, and it needed something like 5 liters of gas and whatever, and was produced 50 years in the same style and whatever. Nothing happened. Very good car. If you have a Mini now, it is more than double of the weight. It has up to 220 horsepower or something like this. And it comes as the Mini and as the Mini SUV and as the Mini Coupe and the Mini Convertible and the Mini SUV Convertible and the Mini Countryman and all these things. Yeah. And people buy this stuff. Yeah. And people, yeah. And at the same time, they vote for the Green Party. At the same time, they are concerned about the future of their kids and whatever. So what this shows us is, and this goes a little bit back to my long introduction about the situational aspects, the orientation that are important for people are given by the material and situational circumstances of the world they live in. It's not so much about reflection. It's not so much about thinking. Yeah? We are all beings that need orientation. Yeah? And the greatest source for orientation is what is there and what functions. And we only start thinking about something if there's an accident or something goes wrong, when something differs from the business as usual thing or the usual expectations. This is the only part where reflection comes into play. And then you have a beautiful explanation if you also have this concept of division of labor and that you have some kind of cognitive department where you can be totally concerned about climate change and on the other hand have the task to bring your kids to the school under the conditions of the giving infrastructure that are totally designed for individual mobility, you will have be full of consciousness about all these problems, but bring them with your SUV to the Waldorf Kindergarten. And same applies to all the decision to fly because it's necessary. I mean, I'm here, yeah? And I didn't go by bicycle, definitely not. And there are many good reasons, yeah, very important to give this talk and whatever. So all the infrastructures are there and they are already determining what you do before you have the first thought about it. And this is much stronger. So, and therefore what we draw as a conclusion out of these suggestions of these ideas and so, is that we thought, okay, we know enough no more research is needed, which is a really surprising thing, as you all know, because you will never find a paper with the sentence "no research is needed anymore," because it's always that we need more research. But in this respect, not. We need something, and this is then not a scientific issue anymore. We need something to break this up, this division of labor, this thing of peaceful coexistence of being concerned and doing the wrong things. So we had an idea to turn the whole communication about these topics totally around and stop talking about the dangers, stop talking about the apocalyptic aspects and whatever. So this book is some way very distant from me now. I mean, it's interesting, but I'm not so identified with the conclusions. What I find much more interesting is to find fields of action where you can do practically something that helps you to move more in the direction of another type of society. Which means, on a general, a more theoretical level, interesting are approaches or projects that go directly into the modes of production and reproduction, or financing things, putting money in something and taking it out of something. So strategies that go directly into the operative mode of the capitalist system. Because we are, in writing books, scandalizing things, and so this is something that is totally expected by everybody. This is part of the whole system. Nobody would worry about it. People would start worrying if there are not the critics and if there are no books in this way. But if you start to act within the giving system and try to change the variables there, it's much more interesting what might come out of it. So this is the theoretical idea. And the other theoretical aspect is, and this is really puzzling also still to me because there's no solution for this, is the basic contradiction or the unsolved problem that this type of economy, capitalist growth economy, had so many positive outcomes. First, in material respect. I mean, the life expectancy of people today is double than a little more than 100 years ago. This is unbelievable. The health conditions is very much better. The working conditions very much better. Many, many aspects that are extremely positive. And all these material comfortable things, that car thing and whatever we can equip your life is very much better. This is one aspect, the material progress that is connected to this system. And the other thing is the immaterial aspects that mean that the success of this economic system was closely related to the development of democracy, the development of nation states with free conditions, with the concept of free persons, autonomous persons, citizenship, and all these other things like legal state and social security, educational system, things like that. So, and this is highly attractive. There was never, I think, never a system before in history that in such a short amount of time made such a visible progress in bettering the concrete living conditions of people, and also developed a civilizatory standard that is in historical comparison completely outstanding. Democracy. It's a good thing. Yeah. And now we have the problem that because of the impact of climate change and all the other environmental problems, societies of our type get so much under stress that we will lose this civilizatory standard. You know, all the discussions about democracy and threatening of democracies and whatever. So there's, again, a shifting of perspective. But the question that I have is, and this is the task we should discuss, is how to maintain the civilizatory standard that we that comes from this capitalist system. How can we maintain the civilizatory standard with a use of material and energy that is lowered to 20% compared to now? Nobody knows how this would work. And this is not gained and achieved by higher efficiency. Yeah. So, and it is will not be possible in keeping this material standard. It has to be less, because I don't have to explain this in this before this audience. So the civilizatory task, and therefore the political task, is what can we do to keep this standard and change everything else? And this is something where if you would find somebody who would know a solution for this, I mean, this would be really a sensation. Nobody knows how this can be achieved, because we have a lot of ideas, we have techniques and things like that. Everybody is totally concentrated on the CO2 and the energy problematic. But all these other aspects of our cultural practices, of our consumer practices and whatever, is not touched by this at all. So how to develop a modern society that turns from an expansive type of society to a reductive type of society? This is really something. So, and as we have no idea how this works, how this will work, and as there is no master plan for things like that, we had the idea that we can do something not only different in the communicative, on the communicative level, but also on the practical. So the idea is very simple, and many people do this already, that we search individuals, projects, groups, companies that under the given conditions of a modern society like the German society do things differently. That means a company who refuses to grow and say, no, we don't want to take part in this type of competition anymore. Companies who would do all the things that are necessary for their production differently than an ordinary company would do. Cooperatives that would find themselves to produce energy on a local level, big thing in Germany. Groups that would take care for a community garden, all these things, repair cafes, million things that are going on, also in the context of transition towns movement and whatever, and to tell stories about it. Not scientific investigations, but simply telling stories about it. So what our foundation does is approaching these people, writing stories about them after visiting them, and communicate these stories on our homepage, but also in the traditional form of books and also in established media like newspapers and television programs, without any kind of moral framework. Because there's never a headline, what you will read now is to save the world. Yeah, it is only because we have a problem. We communicate these stories as stories in itself, because they are good stories. If somebody is running a shoe factory in a completely weird way, and in the end there are very good shoes and everybody is totally happy from the ones who work in this factory, and they get all the material from the region, and they give the workers food from local farmers, bio and organic and whatever, this is interesting in itself. This is interesting in itself. And how this can be managed and achieved is very interesting. So you need the classical form of a story where you have interesting persons, where you can tell something about them, where you can also tell something about difficulties, because a good story is never a story that has only one dimension. And these stories appear to find a lot of interest because it's a completely different way of communicating these topics than we are used to. Newspapers never tell good stories. Never. So we tell good stories. And we tell these good stories not in environmental magazines or in the German Tageszeitung, yeah, where the already converted read it. And so, but we tell them in the most conservative newspapers without any reference frames. So we have a series, for example, in the Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung, which is the most established and the most conservative paper in Germany. And there is a format that is called True Stories from wahre Geschichten, True Stories of a Visible Future. And then there's a story about this shoe guy, yeah, who's producing the shoes and other things. And it's quite surprising because people find it really interesting. And they find it especially interesting because it is not framed as something eco or green or sustainable or climate change or apocalypse now or whatever. Yeah, but interesting in itself. And we did series in public television programs where our cases were transformed into little movies and things like that. So the strategy is to bring positive stories as a kind of, you know, message in a bottle in the norm into the normal society, to bring an idea which is politically important, to show that the business as usual is not without alternatives. And that there are so many different things that each member of the society could identify with this or that, because there are many different positions in a society and not everybody can run a company or whatever, but there are also single persons or students' initiatives and whatever. So, and the idea was to establish this kind of promotion agency for a social movement that doesn't know that it's already existing. This was the basic idea when we set up this foundation. And yeah, this was the long story of the consequences of the book about killing, yeah, in the context of climate change. And maybe it is worthwhile to discuss what the outcomes of this might be, because I think, and I end up with this reflection, that it was of course extremely important what Dennis Meadows and the colleagues did with the Limits to Growth. And it was extremely important what a lot of scientists and academics did after that. And it was also extremely important to have something like a green movement and green parties and so. But all these social developments establish forms of communication and formatting their political agendas that go out of fashion after they have been successful. So if there's somebody in a society like this one here, or the German society, who is under 40 years old, he has never heard anything different concerning the status of the world, different from that is completely devastated and it will be destroyed and whatever. So this is the normal expectation. Nobody is surprised. Oh, there's climate change. Oh, there is depletion of the ocean, whatever. Everybody reads the article with the expectation, bad news. Yeah. So this type of communication doesn't fulfill the function that it perfectly fulfilled in the beginning. Yeah, because it's normal communication. It's played in into the whole surface of communication. Therefore, there has to be something made differently. And the other aspect is that psychologically spoken, it is much more much better to motivate people if you try to tell good stories than having the wrong idea to motivate people to action by telling always catastrophic stories. This is psychologically not very fruitful. Yeah, and the other thing is that with this sample of stories, we learn a lot about which way, which direction can be followed if we really want to go to this type of reductive society, because in this project, they serve as real-life experiments and labors, laboratories, to try to find other ways of using material and energy and doing something with it. And they find also other ways of dealing with each other, that means cultural and social practices. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We will open up the floor for questions. Did you want to stand? Did you want to sit? What do you prefer?
I
want to rest your legs?
Sit.
All right. Will you do the microphone, or should I do the microphone?
I'll pass the microphone in the room. Do you
want to
sit down, or
are
you
going to... I can sit down, too, yeah, sure. And please introduce yourself.
Hi, my name is John Harris, and I'm a Evergreen College student here. I'm just wondering, in your studies, or in these studies, the bugging of the German POWs, was there any difference in the way they were talking about their activities between conscripts, you know, draftees, versus volunteers in the German army?
Draftees versus volunteers, that means there were
not... volunteer to be in the army, or were they forced to be?
They were, I mean, there were, in under conditions of the time, there were 20 million soldiers in the German army, so there were no volunteers, they were all, yeah.
So if I'm understanding your analysis from the German POWs,
can you introduce yourself, please?
Oh, Matt Staffier, professor of chemistry at Endicott College. And it seems like they were able to kill without, or do these atrocities without too much problems if it was a matter of logistics. You know, when you 25, you know, a million Russians surrender, how do you feed them? Well, we may not have the supplies. We have our own war effort. So to win the end game. So you're basically saying that the same thing's going to happen as soon as the developing world starts to slowly fall apart because of all of the... So this is major, major stuff here. And my point is, I think that the world... Why isn't the world embracing nuclear power? I mean, if it really is the bads of nuclear power justifiable with the Holocaust you may be alluding to?
I mean, to be honest, what I could say to this is something that is just, you know, like thinking about this immediately is not something where I can speak on an empirical or qualified level. Yeah? But one important aspect with this nuclear bombing and this type of warfare in the middle of the last century is, of course, the mode of distance between the perpetrators and the victims. What we see in the material, for example, that it's highly dependent from the specific, what is the word for this? I mean, if they were in the Air Force, or if they were in the Army, or if they were with the Marines. Is very different how they perceive the violence. If they fly airplanes and shoot from above, they have really great fun doing it. Yeah, the narratives of the soldiers are very much like you would hear from kids who play video games and so. Yeah, so very distant. So then you like killing. If you are in the infantry, whole thing looks very much different. So what we see in the future of war violence is probably much more, because the distance is so big and the shift in the technique of war is exactly this, that you have less and less and less casualties on the side of the military and much more on the side of the civilians because of the technique that is there. I don't know if this is in any way an answer to your question, but if you are distant as an executioner, you don't face any problems of identification with the victim. You have a complete different situational setting than being directly involved in the things.
Is that still there? What's the moral consequence of being 1/1,000,000,000th responsible for 1 billion deaths?
Can you repeat it?
Well, it just seems like when it comes to climate change and our emissions, we all know the consequences, especially for the developing world. So we are responsible collectively. Mm. And if 1 billion people on the planet can undermine the resources to such that another 1 billion starve to death.
Okay, got it.
So it just seems like that it's just kind of sad that we're heading in this direction and we kind of just go into it so casually. And it, you know, I'd like to live in a world where if you educated someone, they did the right thing.
Yeah. But then you have exactly, this is the point, because this responsibility is only a rhetorical responsibility and is then designed in sustainable products with more efficiency and an SUV that has a hybrid thing and so. And this is the mode how this kind of, you know, uneasy aspects of our living condition is then designed, that we can cope with this cognitive dissonance. Okay, we know this is a big problem, desertification there, floodings, whatever, extreme weather events, bad, really bad. But I bought this extremely efficient fridge now. Yeah. But this is it, yeah? And this is, again, and there's the relation to the question before. There's a relation because there's no concrete requirement of responsibility. This is the thing. This is highly abstract and in a double way abstract, because these are these people there, over there, not here, and this is something in the future. So you have double distance to this, and then you have this everyday tasks and requirements that you have. Yeah? I need this car because it's more safe than the other one. And what these people. A few days ago, I had a panel discussion in Germany where I said something against SUVs. And I said, SUVs, you know what that is? Yeah. These stupid cars. People who buy cars like this suffer from a deficit in social intelligence. And this was, I mean, I was almost, you know, tarred and feathered. But then after a reception afterwards with wine and whatever. So there was a row of people approaching me and explaining why they have to have a SUV, because I'm a veterinary, I drive to the mountains in the winter. Everybody had a specific mode of sense making. They agreed totally, yeah? Person face to face, they agreed, yeah, you are right, these cars are completely, but I need a car like this. And this is the same mode as in many other respects. We can agree on a general level perfectly. We can also take responsibility on a general level. But when it comes to everyday life and everyday decision making, there are total different variables that come into play. And this is a little bit depressing, yes.
Yeah.
I mean, just to go back to your earlier question there, I mean, you can see that in the discussion about drones in the US, right? It's the exact parallel. Why do we have drones? We don't need to get involved. We can do it from a distance. We're not putting risk, you know, lives at risk. That means US soldiers at risk. We put other lives at risk, right? But it sort of distance yourself from the actual killing. There is a very sort of detached discussion around drones.
But it's also relevant because the ones who are detached are warriors.
I think this discussion about one billionth responsibility for the deaths of a billion people is very apropos. But I think you're too negative about environmentalism over the past 50 years since Rachel Carson.
Can you introduce yourself, please? I'm sorry.
Jeffrey Carliner, Economics Department at BU. There's been huge improvements in air quality and water quality in the United States. There have been dramatic improvements in the safety of automobiles, in the safety of workplaces, all sorts of things, dramatic. It hasn't come about primarily by educating people to think right and act right. It's come about by government regulations that say you have to have airbags in the car, you cannot put that garbage into the air, into the water. And people are willing to force politicians to do that when their children are getting emphysema in Los Angeles and when their babies are being tossed out of cars and mutilated. The problem is that it's not their kids that are going to be hurt by desertification and by global warming. It's too far away in time. It's too far away in geography. But it's not that that there are no mechanisms for doing it. It's not that environmentalism is a failure at all. It's just it's fine at home where we can see that we're being affected. It's not so fine when we have a one billionth responsibility for the deaths of a billion people. Another point, or a related point, is failed states have lots of problems. They're horrible places to live. They don't deliver anything reasonable to their populations. It's not mostly about climate change.
No.
It's mostly about the rulers stealing money and exacerbating ethnic tensions and all this other stuff. And you sort of waved your arms at some point to suggest that there was going to be problems like that in the developed world when the Arctic Ocean is open. But that's not really credible. We're not going to go to war with Canada about who gets the right to drill for oil in the Arctic slope. It's a problem with failed states that are failing in all sorts of ways. Now, the answer to how do you deal with global warming, the technical answer is what my chemist friend said, or fellow audience member, don't know your name. Maybe nuclear power, maybe solar, maybe something. How do you get there? Well, technically, you get there by putting on really high carbon taxes and by spending a lot of money on R&D to develop next generation technology to conserve use of energy and to generate clean ways of making energy. Politically, how do you do that? That's much harder because all the people that are going to be harmed by global warming, or most of them, live in sub-Saharan Africa or the Bay of Bengal, and they don't live in Germany or the United States. So we in the United States are so extreme, we deny it's happening. But it's a political problem. It's not a technical problem. And so there are these technical solutions, and they don't have that much to do with mindless consumerism. Now, maybe mindless consumerism is bad for our souls, but it has very little to do with global warming. The fact that you can find 200 coffee pots and more if you went on the internet and save yourself a trip to the mall, that doesn't consume a lot of energy. And
but this is,
you don't have to be so puritanical and say we should get away from consumerism in order to save people in
well,
chat.
I don't think that this is puritanical, because there's a question what this type of consumerism contributes to a good life. I mean, this is the question, and then it's not a puritanical thing that I want to take the SUVs from this happy people who have such a brilliant life that they think they need to add an SUV to this life. But it's a question of what is a good life, and I think the good life is not to have every 3 months a new iPad or something like this, and every year a bigger car and things like that. The opposite is true, because people suffer from this mode of consumerism. We have all kinds of surveys about that people now today spend more time in decision making on what thing to buy than consuming these things. Yeah?
It's bad for your soul, but it has nothing to do with global warming.
So, and now it has a lot of to do with global warming, because you need all this material to produce these things. You need all the transportation, you need all the mobility energy, you need all these things. I mean, this doesn't come from the air or whatever. You need all this stuff. And this, of course, consumes energy and material in an incredible amount.
Don't try to change people's minds.
That's why not?
That's not how air and water were cleaned up in the past 50 years. It was done by
government regulation. Yeah, but it wasn't changed with public relations
campaigns. But the government
regulations
don't come from wise politicians. Yeah, there has to be, of course, a social movement and an environmental movement. I agree totally what you say about the positive effects. I don't want to deny that at all. It was very good. The only thing that I say is that these things have their time, and now we have to think about other strategies. Yeah, but politicians didn't invent these regulations because it popped up in their minds that we have to have restrictions in pollution. This was exactly because of an ecological movement, as with other modernization processes in modern societies. They never come from the elites. They always come from bottom up. And this is something what I'm thinking about, what would be something like a motivational strategy to bring these things much more on the agenda that I'm interested in, other modes of production and whatever. So.
Hi, my name is Claire and I'm a student here. And when you were originally talking about solutions of how to, you know, how to move forward, you briefly mentioned about moving money and investing it in different things and taking money out of other things. And I was wondering if you were alluding to the divestment movement, or if what you were referencing, and if it was about the divestment movement, what you think about it, and just expanding on that.
As far as, of course, I was referring to that. And I don't know so much about it. I read a few articles, and I think it's a brilliant idea. It's an absolutely brilliant idea, as I think that all the strategies that go directly into the market conditions are very good. Yeah, because they have the potential to bring things into trouble. Yeah, and in Germany there's, and also in Austria, there is a movement now that is called Gemeinwohlökonomie, that means economy for public goods or something like this. And it's also very interesting because it's not about divesting, but it's about redefining what the aim of economic action is. And they say, We can, within capitalism, still run our company like we ever did, but the goal for it is not heightening personal profit, but heightening the common good. So, and this is also an interesting movement, and I'm very much interested in these things, like the divestment, because that go deeper than the scandalizing and reflective and cognitive things.
I was just wondering if I could ask in the audience if people could raise their hand if they know about the divestment movement. I'm just personally curious.
Okay, not too bad.
So it's basically to stop investing money in fossil fuel companies. So it's the very, very basics.
Okay. So my name is Ellen Messer, and I teach here at BU in food studies.
Yes.
Yeah. So you had a very wide-ranging talk and several different topics. So I have two separate points that I hope you can respond to. One is the idea that there are groups in civil society who mobilize around environmental issues. And in the U.S., I would say there's sort of been a line from Friends of the Earth in the 1960s through Food First in the 1970s and 80s, and more recently Small Planet Foundation, that do what you talk about, which is to try to develop motivational stories. And basically, while they're very political, what they also are saying, be a drop in the bucket, every drop counts. And they've had trouble raising large constituencies. I mean, that's been a constant challenge for them. but a very large proportion of their constituents are people who either are on the left progressive side, or they're of varying political persuasions, but they are also faith-based, religious. And I know that the faith-based constituencies in Germany are extremely important in a lot of these progressive and environmental movements. I wondered if you could talk a little bit about that, the faith base, the religious base, in as a constituency that supports or is moving in the directions that you find congenial and important.
Yeah, but I don't think that this is really so important. We have, of course, within the Protestant Church, an eye on these topics. And if there are the Kirchentage, the annual big meetings, this, of course, sustainability and things like that is a major thing. But I don't know of many examples of foundations, for example, in this field that have been established from this background. And the church in itself is not very engaged in changing their practices. Although in Germany they are, you know, they are big, also in terms of what they get as money from the state and what they can buy for running their business. So it's not very important.
Okay, so that's interesting, because the conferences that I've been occasionally able to attend, German Brot, for example, is extremely important, and they do see themselves playing in part a foundation role in ethical investment.
German
Brot, bread, your bread for the world.
Ach, Brot für die Welt. Yes.
Forgive my.
Yeah, no. I just wanted to understand. Yeah, so, but Brot für die Welt. You would never perceive Brot für die Welt as an actor in the field that we discuss here. You would always see them as an actor in the very traditional religious way that you have to give something to the poor or something. And they are not active, and they are not present in public discussions and whatever. Yeah, you will always, when you go to the Christmas sermon or so, you would spend some money for Brot für die Welt, but it's not an important player in this field.
Okay, because in international meetings, they do present themselves as a force for ethical investment. That's but we can talk about that further. My second point, though, has to do with sort of reviewing the climate change causes conflict paradigm. I had the opportunity to review that literature for Oxfam America in 2009. And what was interesting there, and again, I was thinking in terms of your search for constituencies, was that the military, the retired military in the U.S., were very interested in how the security framing, particularly the security framing for energy, was extremely important for them as they looked at the world security picture and the U.S. security picture. And they felt that the climate change argument, that climate change causes conflict, was a way to enter into the energy issues. And they saw the security paradigm in that case as being useful for addressing these larger questions. So my question for you is, how is this security paradigm useful or able to be used by your foundation or your interests for going forward and for building constituencies that might not otherwise be there?
Yeah, this is a strategic question. I know this study that you refer to, and we also had a very similar thing by the German Bundeswehr and also from the insurance companies like Münchener Rück and Swiss Re and whatever. And they all provide very good material and data that can be used. But and go also like giving money into foundations and so. This is true. That's simply true, and I think it can be used in public discussions and so as references, and so that you can use for strategic purposes. But yeah, you can do that.
Over there.
My name is Katia. I'm a visiting fellow from University Louis in Rome. I have two questions. I'm working broadly on the question of value shift towards sustainability, towards sustainable development. So your talk was very relevant and interesting for my own perspective. The first point is related to the shift in values and what you were saying about, you know, how long the transition was going on. So you say in Germany it's been at least like 30, 40 years, 1972. Do you think... recently, well, a few years ago, the former head of IPCC, Professor Pachauri, the Nobel Prize winner, he said that we need to shift, we need a shift in how we live life, in our lifestyles, but most probably the generation who is going to do it is the generation that is currently young. These people will be, as children, brought up in a new sort of paradigm of how to live, and they won't be as corrupt as the adults. Who are already used to cheap resources and, you know, all this variety of goods. So as a social psychologist, what would be your perspective? Because in Germany, if it was going on for 30 years, that means that people who are now 30, they were, according to Pachauri, brought up and then, you know, with new values.
Yeah, I think it's misleading. Because when you see the environment that kids grow up in now, it's totally different from the environment that I grew up in, especially in terms of products and goods and mobility and all these things. So when I talk to my students about these things, with very intensive seminars, and students are always very good in going along with new ideas and things like that. But last month I ended up a discussion with, okay, we are now at the point, give away your iPhones, here is a basket, put it in, you will never get it back. Yeah, then end of discussion. Then they would say, oh nay, and then it comes this SUV thing, I need it because, and I need this and that. So there are certain things that are already part of the what we would call the assumptive reality that belongs to the world as it is. You cannot think the world without it. And the problem is that every new generation grows up under these circumstances, under these conditions that are provided by the generation before. Therefore, the argument is misleading. I think the much better argument would be the head of the IPCC, me, you, everybody who is here and who has a privileged position in a society like this, is responsible for changing what he or she does and not delegating this to a fictive next generation. Because this is what gives the examples. I mean, this extreme, we had this already, the extreme tendency, and this is also part of the way we are used to cope with questions of responsibility and so, always to address it to somewhere else, to the politicians, to the next generation, to this Chinese, yeah, who are much worse than we, and whatever. Yeah, there's always somebody to blame. The only one who is definitely not to blame is everybody who is in a room where there's a discussion like this. Yeah, because we are all good. So the only task we have is how to convince others to be as good as we are. Yeah, this is the mode. And I think it's always, and it's I found it difficult for myself, and I'm far away from having a sustainable lifestyle. Yeah, but I try to do it and become better in it. So the first step might be to take oneself and the data that one has seriously and not unseriously. May I tell an anecdote that is really striking? 2 years ago, there was a huge conference in Germany, 40 years of limits to growth, an anniversary conference. And this conference had the aim to check out where we stand now. Yeah, there was this scenario and the updated scenarios, and where are we now in this respective areas of climate change, of ocean depletion, of acidification, whatever, yeah? So 160 international scientists have been there to give the reports about the status of the world. And the funny thing was that Dennis Meadows himself was giving the keynote. And Dennis Meadows was giving the keynote in a way that he simply said, forget about all these stupid ideas. We are not in a status anymore that we can find a path for sustainability. Game over. We could have found it 30 years ago, maybe 20 years ago, but now all the parameters are, you know, in this, they are fixed in this way. And the only thing we can do, and this is what I would recommend, is making people resilient, because stress will grow up. And the only thing is teach resilience. This is the only thing. So we can discuss if this is correct or not, and what if Dennis Meadows is right or not, or whatever. But what was really interesting is that in the following 40 talks and presentations and all these PowerPoints and these beautiful diagrams, there was not the slightest reference to the keynote. And everybody was giving his depressing data. Really, there was nothing positive, no development that was better than expected. Everything was really bad, and all many, many diagrams. And every talk ended with, we have to do something about it. We have to immediately, we must, yeah? So, and this is the usual turn, because nobody takes its own results seriously. If climate researchers would take their results seriously, why would they fly and organize all these conferences where you have to fly? There has to be a transfer to the practices, and there's nobody in the world to organize this transfer as you and me and the people that are there in this respective moment. I think this is very simple. It's almost too simple, but this is the point. And there's nobody where you can delegate this to. Very funny.
Just briefly, the second point, as a social psychologist again, what is your opinion about the growing number? There's a growing literature on the economy, like economic approach to sustainability through the commons, managing the commons. Mm-hmm. To commons approach, and they look at, you know, the emerging eco villages and yes. things like Craigslist or you know, barter or open source data. From the perspective of social psychology, what is there a potential to this approach? Because that requires certain trust and decomposing the reality into smaller entities yes. than nation states.
The potential, to my point of view, out of the perspective of a social psychologist, is high, because what happens within these activities and projects is that people experience themselves different when they do these things, like together with others, making experience with others, and having results that they can see. So it's the question of self-efficacy. You see something, you experience yourself different from the mode that you've done before, doing business as usual. So it's a positive experience, and this positive experience motivates you to go further with these things. This is what we can always observe, that the tendency, as soon as somebody tries something, tries to experiment something different, there's another way of experiencing yourself. And then they say, oh, this is fun. I didn't know that this would happen. And you come into other groups and whatever. So this is really important. And I think the potential is relatively high, because it gives the people back a feeling of autonomy, while the technical solutions keep them in the status of consumers. Yeah, and if you have all this in Germany, there's this big thing of Energiewende, and they apply all kinds of smart meters in the home and make all kinds of material in the outside of the houses, so the people are sitting inside and don't use that much energy, but it's not their thing. They don't have anything to do with it. And this is highly problematic. So I think the potential for this self-accelerating change is much more on the social level than on the technical level. And therefore, and you have this worldwide movement of the community gardens. This is based on this principle that people do something together and make new experiences with each other, which is, by the way, the strongest aspects for the success of social movements. It's not that much the goal of these movements. It's the concrete experience of trying to establish other structures together with other people.
Hi, Magdalena Tabor. I'm an artist from Germany. my question is the consumerism and the eternal hunger for more and more, do you think that it's part of human nature and therefore your approach is somewhat doomed? Or is it artificially created by capitalism and there's some hope to build a different set of value that would steer us in the direction of taking personal responsibility instead of continuing the way that we are?
Mm-hmm. I think it is not artificially established by capitalism, but every type of culture and economy produces certain mentalities and psychic formations. Therefore, if we have a capitalist economy, we it's kind of inevitable to have individualistic personality concepts, for example, that we have an idea of competition. And this idea of competition goes into what people think about themselves in their relationship to others, whatever. So what I want to say is that this type of greed and what the words for this is, concurrence, competition, is directly related to capitalism, but not as something that was installed, but that was a developmental outcome of a changing economic system. This is the interesting thing. This makes it so difficult to change it. Although it's just 200 years old, that doesn't matter that much, yeah, in terms of broader historical perspectives, but it is there. And this is again then the question is, what do kids learn in school? What do kids learn when they grow up in a society like this? They learn essentially that you have to beat the others, that you have to be better in any respect and whatever. And then you have this value rhetorics. Oh, come on. Yeah, be responsible, be honest. But the practice is in itself unresponsible because you have to be better than the others. Anthropologically spoken, there's something totally positive because I think, and we have a lot of data from neurodevelopmental scientists as evolutionary psychologists and whatever, the human life form is a cooperative life form. It is, because the constitutive level of how people grow up is that they grow up inevitably in under social conditions. This is, there are always the others. There's no single human brain. A brain is always a social product with its structure, the neurological structure. So therefore, the whole idea, the homo economicus and what economists say, is not something that has to do with the anthropology of the human life form. That is untrue. This is cooperative in itself. But we have, of course, historical and cultural formations where you would put something into the foreground. And if you take it related to everyday experiences, I mean, if it comes to crisis, personal crises, if people face death, if people have severe illnesses or accidents and whatever, what you always hear is, I would give away all my money if I could, yeah, go back to this and that situation. And then it's all about relationships. And human life is about relationships. Very, very basically, and not about bigger or smaller cars or something like this. But we think, and there's reason to think in this way, because otherwise you won't make a career, that the basic is not relationship, but to fulfill whatever, this and this, and you have to earn this and that, and you have to follow these steps and whatever. So, but this is historically and cultural specific. The problem is that it spreads all over the world.
You said earlier that Jeff Hauser. You said that earlier that climate doesn't care about climate change. The cultures and individuals do, but other species do too as well. Yes, even though they can't conceptualize it. Yes. Now, if what you say is true about coming greater conflicts and violence, will other species be put in a double bind? First of all, by the direct effects of climate change, as well. Secondarily, of the effects of violence on the part of human species, as well as an even greater lack of care and understanding for other species because of the desperation of their own plight. We not only cooperatively depend on other people and collective wisdom through the ages, we even more depend on the collective effects of the biosphere and what other species contribute to it. And the real question is, can we relate to the needs and intrinsic value of other species beyond ones which are cute, like seals and panda bears and so forth, and appreciate the true status that other species really have in this world beyond our own factitious desires and cares and appetites?
Very complicated question. I mean, there was just this case with this giraffe that was Copenhagen Zoo, yeah, where people are completely out of their minds to see this giraffe is given to lions, and have no idea what lions normally eat. They are not vegan, yeah? And on the other hand, they consume all these things from all these Massentierhaltung and so. So I have no answer to this. There's the only thing that I can see there is that there is a broader movement now in the rich societies to live vegan or vegetarian and to be more responsible. And we have many publications since Jonathan Safran Foer and whatever, who would be writing about animal rights and... So there's a development, but the practice is totally different.
You don't see any socio-psychological exit from that?
Then? No, not in the moment. No. I mean, the only thing, and maybe we can end up the discussion then, because I lose my voice. The only thing is something like a personal experience, because I'm not a vegetarian and I don't care much about animal rights and so. But there is a German journalist who wrote a book, a very radical book about these issues, and forced me to read this book because I know her quite well. And I said, I'm not interested. And she said, okay, but read it. I want that you read it, and I want that you make a comment for the cover of the book, because I find this book really important. And then I read this manuscript, and my feeling was that I thought, I don't want to read it, because it's so convincing and she's right. And if I would take it serious, I have to change my position towards these animals and my consumer habits concerning meat and things like that. So it's one of those typical examples that this book did something with me. And and the social psychological answer would be, again, here is the direct relationship to the one who wrote this book. So it's again something about the relationship. It would, if it would have been, I read this book by Fur. I didn't care much about it. It didn't make anything with me because I don't know this guy, and the whole thing was not very convincing. As soon as you have this concrete angle where you can approach a topic, then it becomes powerful. Yeah, and this is again then the strength of these groups and social communities and so, because then, independent of abstract motives and theories, people can identify with these things and in the end identify with certain goals that they never have thought about, but they become active in following these goals. This would be my not so social psychology, but some answer.
All right, thank you very much. I'll thank our speaker.